from verse 49, excuse me, down to 56. The first part of this particular chapter, the Israelites could virtually say that wonderful old adage from that fabulous song in the 60s, I've been everywhere, man. Because that's what that's all about. That's why I'm not reading all of that, because it's a bit too much reminiscent of that old song. Okay, so from verse 49, their camp lay along the Jordan in the plains of Moab, from Beth Sheshemoth to Abel Shittim. While there along the Jordan in the plains of Moab opposite Jericho, Moses was told by the Lord, say to the people of Israel, after you have crossed the Jordan into the land of Canaan, you are to drive all the native residents out of your area, smash all their stone idols and molten images, and demolish all their high places. Then take possession of the land and live there, for I have given you the land to occupy. In this connection, you are to divide the property among yourselves by lot, according to the size of your families. The one with the largest number shall receive the largest inheritance. The one with the fewest shall receive the smallest inheritance. Each shall have whatever falls to him by lot. Furthermore, you are to apportion the land according to your paternal tribes. If you fail to drive out the native residents from your area, then that portion that you allow to remain shall be as barbs in your eyes and thorns in your sides, for they shall be a constant source of irritation to you in the country in which you settle. And sooner or later, I will do to you as I had originally intended doing to them. Now turn to Jeremiah. And we are in chapter 2, verse 4. And we're reading down to verse 28. And then there's just one more little verse, chapter 3 and verse 4 after that. Listen to the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, and every family of the house of Israel. Thus speaks the Lord. What injustice did your fathers find in me, that they abandoned me, habitually followed after futility and became useless? None of them said, where is the Lord, the one who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, the one who brought us through the wilderness, through a land of steps and pits, through a land of deep darkness, and through a land that no man passes through or inhabits? Then I brought you into a garden land, to eat of its fruit and its good things. But when you went in, you defiled my land and made my inheritance an abomination. Even the priests did not say, where is the Lord? The experts of the Lord did not know me. The rulers rebelled against me, and the prophets prophesied for Baal and pursued things which did not profit. Nevertheless, I again will plead with you, says the Lord, and with your children's children I will plead. For cross over to the isles of Kittim and see, also send to Kedar, carefully consider and see if anything like this has happened. Has a nation ever changed its gods, though they were not gods? But my people have exchanged their glory for something that does not profit. Be awestruck, O heavens, at this. Bristle with horror and be exceedingly desolate, says the Lord, because my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of their living waters, and they have hewn out for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns, which cannot hold water. Is Israel a servant or a home-born slave? Who has he become a victim? Why has he become a victim? The young lions have roared over him and they have made their voice resound. They have made his land a waste and his cities a ruin without inhabitants. Also the men of Nob and Taphanes have shorn the crown of your head. Did you not bring this onto yourself when you forsook the Lord your God when he guided you in the way? And now, what are you doing in the ways of Egypt to drink of the waters of the Nile? And what are you doing in the ways of Assyria to drink from the waters of Euphrates? You will be chastened by your own wickedness. Your own backslidings will reprove you. Therefore, know and see that this evil and bitter thing is due to your forsaking the Lord your God and having no reverence for me, says the Lord God of hosts. From of old you have shattered your yoke and have snapped your bands. Also you have said, I will not serve thee. Yes, upon every high hill and under every shady tree you have bowed down like a harlot. Yet I, on my part, planted you as a choice vine of completely reliable stock. How then did you turn into bastard shoots of an alien vine to me? Although you wash yourself with nitre, and though you use soap, abundantly your perversity is still ingrained before me, says the Lord God. How can you say I have not followed after Baals? Look at your action in the valley and realize what you have done. You are as a swift young she-camel entangling her walk, like a wild donkey accustomed to the wilderness in the heat of her passion, snuffing up the wind in the time of her mating, who can turn her lust away. All those pursuing her will not be disappointed, because in her month they shall find her. Protect your foot from bareness and your throat from dryness. But you have said repeatedly, it is useless, because I love strangers and after them I will go. As a thief is ashamed when he is caught, just so the house of Israel is ashamed. They, their kings, their princes, their priests, and their prophets, who say to a piece of wood, you are my father, and to a stone, you have borne me. But to me they have turned the neck and not their faces. However, in the time of calamity, they will cry, arise and deliver us. Where now are your gods that you manufactured? Let them arise, if in the hour of calamity they can deliver you. Notice, your gods are as numerous as your cities. O Judah. Chapter 3, verse 4. Have you not just now cried to me, my father, thou art a friend from my youth?
Thanks, Rebbetzin. You might wonder why on earth and what significance verse 4 of chapter 3 has in relation to what Glenys just read. Jews do not like to end on a heavy note. They don't like to end anything on a heavy note. So they always look for something that is positive. And of course that was rather heavy, so they decided, we'll put that in now so we can all be happy and clap hands and rejoice. It's a bit like Malachi. In the Jewish translation, they actually repeat a particular verse. If you have a look over in Malachi, Malachi, of course, was Ezra, the scribe. If you have a look at chapter 4 and verse 6, if you've got a Christian Bible, not a Jewish Bible, because it'll have a different chapter and so forth. If you have a look at verse 5, it says, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with utter destruction. Now, some of you may have a different ending. Just have a look at your Bibles if you've got a different ending to that. Have a quick look.
A curse.
Yeah, well, apart from a curse, I'm talking about an actual repeat of the verse. In question. Do you have that?
You don't have that except with a curse.
Yeah, no. The word with a curse is equal to utter destruction.
Oh, yeah.
Right? But they actually won't finish Malachi on that particular verse. They will actually repeat another verse. Just seeing if you've actually got it there.
No, I haven't. No. It just says the end of the prophet.
All right. That's homework for you for this week. You can go away and have a look. And see, do some study and see, what do the Jews do with the last verse of Malachi? All right? You're going to say something?
No, I wasn't.
Go home, do some homework, have a little look, and you will see what I'm talking about. That's your homework. Yes?
In my Jewish Bible, our trip finishes, I will strike the land with complete destruction. Then it's kind of bracket. And it says, look, I will send to you Elijah the prophet before you. So is that what
you're about? Yes, they repeat it again. Forget the homework this week.
That's in the
Jewish Bible. Yes, that's right. They simply, it's not there in the scroll. They simply repeat it so that we end on a positive note. Not out of destruction, but I will send you Elijah.
Isn't that great?
It's wonderful.
It is. Yeah. But we do that, don't we? We do that in Messiah. We say it's all coming to an end, this system, and with that it's going to come horrendous calamity. But it's okay because Yeshua's coming back and he's going to restore it all.
That's exactly right. Yeah. And we must finish always on a positive note. That's a new couple.
Please close the front door if you're cold and in a draft there. By all means, it keeps the place warm.
This is the last passage reading from Numbers for this cycle, and we're given a list of 42 journeys and encampments, hence them saying, you know, forget this, I'm not reading through all of this, and I don't blame her, not in the least, because 40 years of wandering in the wilderness on a trip that should have taken at the most 11 days, sort of raise your eyebrows a little bit. But mention is made of cities allocated to the Levites, and of course in this passage there are inclusion of cities of refuge for people who are accused of manslaughter, where they can go until the high priest at the time finally dies. The reason for that is a very genuine concern for not just the victim, the relatives of the victim, but also the person accused of manslaughter and his relatives as well. In other words, if he stays in the city of refuge long enough so that the high priest dies, the chances of reprisal will be minimized. Yeah, that's good teaching. People go to jail, they pay their due to society, and when they're released, there's always a possibility of some idiot taking matters into their own hands and saying, that wasn't good enough, I'm going to finish it. And, you know, it's a horrible attitude. And certainly, there are a lot of other things included in this section of Scripture as well. But I'm going to come straight to the point. Israel spent 40 years in the wilderness and 42 encampments and journeyings. Six-sevenths of 42. And it is interesting, when they finally got to the plains of Moab, they had a beautiful view of the promised land. So in actual fact, they had to then get up and cross the Jordan. Well, that would have been a 43rd disencampment, if there is such a word. But each time, a mysterious cloud would appear over Israel, hovering above them in the daylight hours, and it would be motionless, so they would set up camp, and then it would get up and move on, and at night it would turn into a blazing pillar of fire. And you would probably say, well, you know, why would it do this? Why would it do this? But as I've pointed out over and over again, that whole period of time, the earth was off its axis. The sun was not in its normal pattern of appearing every 24 hours. It didn't rise in the east and set in the west. Histories of that second millennium BC say that the sun rose in the west and set in the east. And you've got the plains of Nazca in South America, where they were so excited when the sun finally reappeared on the horizon, they would build certain lines out toward the horizon. And then when it would appear again weeks later, they would draw another line out to the horizon, and then they would create, through stonework, the constellations where the sun had been, so that they would get an idea of the regular pattern of this erratic sun behavior. Because the whole world at that stage, or at least the Middle East, was in darkness. And when you understand that the Israelites were trudging around for 40 years in darkness, then of course you've got the pillar of fire at night, you've got this cloud in this murky period that we call day, and that gave Israel an understanding of what was day and night. Because they didn't have watches, they didn't have clocks, right? They didn't have the sun setting, they didn't have the moon coming out, it was dark. They were walking in the valley of the shadow of death all that time. And when you look at the description the psalmist gives of that period of time, there's gloom all around the place.